resistance is futile.
Boldly going where no show has gone before. This is the Week in Geek with David D. Squared, your source for geek and pop culture news that's trending now. Broadcasting from the Gregory Ricks and Associates Wealth Management Studios, here's D. Squared.
Greetings, people of Earth. This is the Week in Geek, your source for geek and pop culture news that's trending now. I'm your host, D. Squared. All right, let me lay out the show for you real quick. The Super Bowl is going on right now, so newsflash, I'm not really here in the studio. But I have a great show in store for you. We got our boy Skungy with his pick of the week, and we're going to be talking about the Microsoft debacle with trying to raise the prices on Xbox Live. And then we'll be joined by Dan Frey, author of The Future Is Yours. It's coming out this Tuesday, February 9th. He and I dig into what the book is all about. It's got a little time traveling theme, but it's a technology and it's in the epistolary form, which is like correspondence. But also, his book is now going to be an HBO Max series, or they're working on making it an HBO Max series. And we get into what Hollywood does and about reboots and just the laziness of Hollywood in general. And then we wrap up tonight's show with Don McLean, songwriter in the Songwriting Hall of Fame, the creator of American Pie. It is the 50th anniversary of American Pie this year. Let that sink in. Bye-bye, Miss American Pie is 50 years old. We'll talk with Don. Don goes on a bit of a rampage. Let me just say this. I thought the interview was going to go sideways on me when he goes, well, you know, the media just wants to talk about American Pie. Well, it is the 50th anniversary, Don. Okay? So we're kind of talking about that. But he goes off on this tangent about what lyrics mean, and you're going to want to stick around for that. So our boy Skungy with his pick of the week. Dan Frey, The Future Is Yours, and Don McLean right here on The Week in Geek on News Talk 99.5 WRNO. What do you get the nerd who has everything? A gift card from D4 Tabletop Gaming Cafe, and let them figure it out. D4 Tabletop Gaming Cafe at 8228 Oak Street is open for the holidays. So head over and check out their expanded inventory of miniatures and miniature paints, board games, RPGs, TCGs. Or you can reserve a table for your next game night. Find them on Facebook at D4 Tabletop Gaming Cafe or go to their location at 8228 Oak Street, just two blocks off of Carrollton. Or go to their website at d4cafe.biz.
Are you suffering from live music withdrawals? Would you believe that New Orleans' best bands are being captured by a mad scientist, experimented upon mercilessly, and forced to play for their very lives? It's horrifying, but you can help. Sundays at 8 p.m., tune in and enjoy groups of all styles on Escape from the Secret Lab, New Orleans' maddest weekly live game show. Watch it now, before it's too late.
Too late? It is already too late! Watch and learn at escapefromthesecretlab.com!
Hello, wonderful friends! It is I, Starfire of Tamaran, here to tell you, you are listening to The Week in Geek on the radio. This is the radio, yes?
You bet your sweet patootie it is, Starfire. Welcome back into The Week in Geek, your source for geek and pop culture news that's trending now. I'm your host, D Squared. Now, as always, I want to strongly urge you to check out the Facebook page, facebook.com/TheWeekInGeek. Check out our website at twigradio.com. Follow us on Twitter at Twig Radio and the Instagrams, The Week in Geek. Hey, Skungy, how can people listen to this show?
Well, if you missed any of part of tonight's show or you want to hear your favorite part again, you can always find us on Spreaker.com, or you can download Spreaker on your smartphone or tablet. We're also on Spotify, Spreaker, and the iHeart Radio app. I'm not even going to sing it because I can't even say it.
Thank God.
Skungy's pick of the week.
I am not what you would call a handsome man.
I love lamb.
I love lamp.
Skungy's pick of the week.
You might be an idiot savant.
Woohoo! Skungy, what's shaking, bacon?
Apparently, the inability to speak and say words is what's shaking.
No, it's all right. You know, I we've always had your pick of the weeks sponsored by GameStop. You know, I'm wondering, should we have it like sponsored by Robin Hood or something now? Or
one of those, you know, sponsored by Wall Street.
Yes. Yeah. All right, man. What are we talking about today, brother?
So we are talking about Scott Pilgrim versus the World Complete Edition, the video game.
Dun, dun, dun!
So, this year is the 10th anniversary of the release of the Scott Pilgrim vs. the World movie.
Wow. That's been that long?
It's been 10 years. Now, just to refresh, Scott Pilgrim vs. the World is a game that came out, a movie that came out based off of a comic series, a graphic novel series, which, believe it or not, the series wasn't even finished when the movie came out, and the movie influenced the parts of the ending of the comic, which is really cool.
Game of Thrones? They haven't finished the book
not
yet?
Not that bad. No, not that. Not like that. Yeah. So, yeah, it had Michael Cera. It had a bunch of people. Chris Evans. There were so many different people in this movie. And I don't know what it was about this movie, but it just struck a chord with me. I loved it. Every single bit about it, because I mean, it was basically a love letter to video games. So that could have been it.
Yeah.
And the entire movie is like a video game. Well, they decided to make a video game based off of it using the art style from the comic book. And it's a side scroller beat 'em up game. Now this game released 10 years ago when the movie came out. And then due to licensing issues and whatnot, it was pulled from the PlayStation 3 store and the Xbox 360 store. You could not. Now, if you previously owned it, if you still had it downloaded on your system, you could still play it, but you couldn't re-download it or anything like that.
Okay.
Well, they heard the outcry and the game, they decided, Ubisoft decided, you know what, we're going to fix this licensing issue and we're going to re-release the game with all the extra content.
Look at that. They heard all the gnashing of teeth and wailing and pulling of hair and they did something. Who knew? Who knew?
Yeah, exactly. So this game is a love letter to the old school side-scrolling beat-em-up games, a la like Ninja Turtles or the Dungeons and Dragons games and stuff
Double
like that.
Double Dragon.
But it uses some of the mechanics of a very popular cult favorite game for the regular Nintendo called River City Ransom.
Okay.
It played and almost looked like the Double Dragon style. Well, with this game you're going to go through, you're going to collect coins, like money. Every time you beat somebody up, you collect money. And then as you go through levels, you're going to stop at shops and you're going to buy upgrades where, you know, hey, you can refill your health or, hey, you're going to get stat bonuses or stuff like that. You also level up your character in this one, which will unlock more combos. You get better health, more defense and whatnot. So it's got an RPG element to it as well.
Sweet.
And this game takes all the tropes of video games and basically just mashes them together. Everything, like the sound effects like if you've ever played a brawler in your life, you're going to pick up this game and instantly know what to do. And that's a great thing about the design. You don't need like a long tutorial or anything like that. You're going to pick up the controller and exactly know what to do.
I'm a fan of that.
And it takes, you get to play as multiple different characters. You can play as like Scott Pilgrim, Ramona Flowers, Knives Cho, and it came with the extra characters. I think Knives and Wallace were not available in the original game, and they added them into this one. So you're getting some bonus stuff. It's tough. You can play the entire game co-op, too, like two-player co-op.
Like online or couch co-op?
Both.
Oh, okay. Sweet.
And it's tough. I mean, like those old-school brawlers were. I mean, it's got that feel of a quarter muncher. From the 80s, I mean, I don't know how many times how much money I spent on the Turtles machine trying to beat it.
Yeah, let's not talk about that. Keep going.
Well, this game is going to be tough. So, but thank God for continues and whatnot. And so you don't have to worry about dropping quarters on it anymore. But it's, man, this is just such a rich, fun, nostalgic experience of that throwback, everything, like I said, from the graphic design of the game. And if you're a fan of the comic or the movies, you're going to see stuff in it that goes throwback to the movies and the comic. And it goes right along with it. It feels like this was taken. And a lot of times IPs don't get the love that they deserve. And this one gets everything. I mean, every attention to detail. And the fact that Ubisoft came out 10 years later and said, you know what, 10th anniversary, we're going to give it to you.
That's pretty sweet, man. All right, so I guess what? Price and platform, man.
So it's going to be on the PlayStation 4, PlayStation 5. You can download it on both. The Xbox Series, the Xbox One or the Xbox Series X. It's also on the Switch, and it's
$14.99. What?
Oh, yeah, because, I mean, that's the one thing. It's not the longest game in the world because it's a beat-em-up, you know?
Yeah, right.
The things that kept those games long back in the day was having to drop quarters and you were standing in front of a machine. You can beat, like... You can beat the Dungeons & Dragons beat-em-up in, like, maybe an hour, hour and a half, you know, if you play straight through.
It's been a while, but I would always keep trying to find those stupid little secret doors. Like, when you got into the dungeon and you could keep going in those doors, I would keep doing that. And then that would cost me more money in the long run because I'd keep dying in the treasure rooms.
True. God, those games are so hard.
I know, right? So, price and platform is covered. Now, there's... I guess, speaking of prices and platforms, let's talk about Microsoft, man. What refresh everybody's memories about the whole situation?
Okay, so a couple of weeks ago, Microsoft decided in their infinite wisdom that, you know what, we think that maybe people are not paying enough money for Xbox Live. Now, Xbox Live has traditionally been $59.99 a year, and that will get you the ability to play online with your friends. It gets you discounts on digital content in the store on certain stuff, and then they have their deal, their games with gold, where every month there are four games that are available to download for you to keep. Two of them on the Xbox One, two of them that were 360 games. So
yes,
four games throughout the month. And you get to keep those even if you're no longer a gold member. That is awesome. That's always cool. They've been pushing more and more for you to get the ultimate, which is Xbox Live and Game Pass. Now, I've talked about Game Pass at nauseam. I think it's a fantastic deal. It's worth it. You save money because you don't have to pay for some of these first-run games and whatnot, and you get to download over 100 games and play them. It's almost like Netflix for the Xbox.
Yeah, I mean, I like it. It's just that I think as an adult, I just don't have the damn time. And since they're only on there for limited time sometimes, I can't find the time to sit down and try to blow through a game. Not like for younger adults and kids. I mean, hell yeah, it's worth its weight in gold. I mean, I've lost track of how many games my son has added and then deleted off the damn Xbox, you know, so... I get all that. So what ended up happening? They were like, no, we got to charge you some more?
Yeah, so they were thinking about the Xbox Live, and they decided we're upping the price of Xbox Live. And they decided to up the price of Xbox Live double to $120 a year.
Oh, my God.
That is not the Game Pass included. That was Xbox Live.
Holy crap nuggets.
So... That lasted about 24 hours.
Right? Okay.
So the internet, which sometimes the internet does good things, you know.
And it exploded.
Sometimes the internet is a horrible, terrible place full of scum and villainy, and you should never go there. But sometimes there's a bright, shining hope in the internet, and it was that day where they basically trashed Microsoft. And Microsoft, not 24 hours later, said, you know what? We are thankful of our community and whatnot and how they're brought to our attention that maybe this wasn't the best idea.
You know, I mean, that's the thing is that honestly, there were times where even the $60, I was like, man, y'all suck. You know, like I have to buy it just so I'm like, here's what ended up happening. I remember bringing this up on the air with you when they first sort of made the change with the pass and all that stuff was that I bought Xbox Live again because I'd let it lapse. So I wasn't, you know, it wasn't that big of a deal, but I was playing Fortnite with Dean again. And so I needed it for that. And I bought the whole year because it was cheaper. But then they were rolling out the Battle Pass and all the other stuff where it's just like, you know, I was concerned that I was going to get shafted for the rest of the year and have to buy this new thing. So now it's just kind of staying the same. When are they getting rid of Xbox Live? That's you know.
They're not getting rid of Xbox Live. It's staying there. It's just they were trying to maybe slip, let's try to make a little bit more money because Xbox Live is so popular. But in doing this, Microsoft fixed a flaw in their servers with this. They made the announcement also. They're like, we're sorry. We made the mistake on doing this. And for that, we are going to be like everybody else, and you are no longer required to have an Xbox Live membership to play Fortnite.
Nice! That is awesome! That is awesome!
So that's huge news. Because
yeah,
no other server do you need to do it for except for Microsoft. So that, you know what, they're like, man, we messed up. Let's fix this.
Well, you know what? Is it still kind of keeping that ongoing fight how, you know, Epic Games decided to stand up to Apple and all that stuff? Is that still going on where they're fighting with Apple and everything?
There's still Apple's always, but Apple's like the conglomerate, that evil, you know.
Yeah, right.
Big brother type thing, it feels. But the news has, there hasn't been a lot of news about it as of lately. So Fortnite won with the prices for their cards and their battle passes and everything, like 10,000 V-Bucks.
Yeah, I mean, it's still,
Only $7.99.
Yeah.
It's not $10.
No, so, I love that. Yeah. That made Christmas a little more tolerable for me this year. So, all right. So now everything's just back to normal. They're giving us free Fortnite without having to pay for Xbox Live. But what happens next, man? What's going on next?
I don't know. I mean, it's kind of like the question is, what were they trying to accomplish with this? Where were they trying to go? But like I said, they've been trying to push the fact of Ultimate for the longest time. I'm thinking that maybe they were doing that price to try to get people to stop using just Xbox Live and move over to Game Pass Ultimate. That's the only thing that I can think of.
You know,
it still would be cheaper if you got, it would be cheaper than $120 a year if you did Ultimate.
Right. But that's just to price it out for that, you know, that's kind of a jerk move. So the Game Pass is how much though again?
So Game Pass is $10 a month. If you want to do Xbox Live is $10 a month. So if you do Game Pass Ultimate, it's $14 a month.
Okay.
So it's $5 more, and you still get Live, but then you get the Game Pass. So that's the kind of thing. It's like, I think that's what they were going for. They were trying to outprice the single so you would take the bundle.
Gotcha. Well, all right. Well, at least they listen to the free market. See, the free market always wins, man. It always wins.
Absolutely.
All right, Skungy, get out of here. I'm not going to fire you this week. You survive another week. All right, coming up next, Dan Frey, the author of The Future Is Yours, comes out this Tuesday, February 9th. It's also been optioned by HBO Max. So we're going to talk to Dan Frey next. The Future Is Yours. It's like this weird new take on time travel, but not really. They build a computer that sees a year into the future. So I want to say hilarity ensues, but not. It's more apocalypse ensues. Coming up next, Dan Frey, right here on The Week in Geek on News Talk 99.5 WRNO.
Meet George Jetson.
Prose Productions is a leading independent publisher on the cutting edge of new pulp and genre fiction today. At Prose Productions, you'll find fiction featuring fast-paced action and adventure, larger-than-life protagonists, over-the-top characters, and tight yet extravagant plots. Prose specializes in prose books, anthologies, audiobooks, and more. Go to prose-press.com to find our monthly release schedule and more info about our great titles. Prose Productions is your first-rate publisher of new pulp fiction today.
Box tea again? Why don't you try the tea blends from the Viridian Tea Company? They sell blends that are guaranteed to make you think outside the box. With blends like Quantum Mechanics, Caligula's Herbal Nerve Tonic, and Manta Ray Dreaming, your tea experience will be out of this world. Look for the blends at Tubby and Coos Mid-City Bookshop at 432 North Anthony Street or online at Etsy at the Viridian Tea Company. So put down the box and order some tea from the Viridian Tea Company today. Sincerely, your taste buds.
My name is Optimus Prime, and you are listening to The Week in Geek. Autobots, transform and roll out.
Welcome back into The Week in Geek, your source for geek and pop culture news that's trending now. I'm your host, D Squared. Let's go to the guest line. This came across my email a while back, and I've been waiting for this day for a while now. The Future is Yours comes out February 9th. The author, Dan Frey, is with us. Dan, how are you doing today, buddy?
I'm doing great. It's a beautiful day in Los Angeles, so I'm feeling good.
It's cold here in New Orleans for some inexplicable reason. I don't know. I like, we only have like really two seasons here, crawfish season and hot season. That's really about all we got down here. So the cold really throws us off. But Dan, look, The Future is Yours is coming out February 9th. And this book, it's written in the epistolary style, like through correspondence and letters and emails and things. But The Future is Yours is, in essence, kind of like not a time travel novel. It's, they created a way to look into the future. So, I guess real quick, give me the elevator pitch for people out there real quick.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm really excited to get to talk to you about it. Your audience is definitely who this book is made for. So, The Future is Yours is, I would say it is kind of a twist or a riff on the idea of a time travel narrative. And it's basically about these two best friends from college named Ben and Adi, who kind of join forces a few years after they've graduated when they're lost and broke in Silicon Valley. And they invent this new technology, which is essentially a personal computer that can connect with itself 1 year into the future, so they can go online and read the news and listen to music and everything from 1 year ahead. And they decide to deliver this technology to the masses and market this product. And it becomes kind of a startup story, almost like The Social Network, but with this kind of high concept sci-fi twist. And of course, as they start building out their company and raising money, everything starts going wrong, and it threatens to destroy the entire world. So it's sort of a dreams come true, rags to riches story that then becomes a nightmare in a way and unravels their friendship and tanks the stock market and, might foretell the apocalypse in the process.
Dan Frey, author of The Future is Yours, comes out February 9th. Look, you know, it's almost as if everybody got a copy of the Gray's Sports Almanac, right? And they can all kind of, you know, go to the track and bet their favorite horses and win. That's kind of like, you know, if everybody wins the lottery, then, you know, it kind of defeats the purpose, right? Now, with this, though, this is something that piqued your, maybe not interest, but the inspiration was kind of watching Zuckerberg getting grilled by Congress, right?
That's exactly right. Yeah, the first sort of inkling of wanting to do this book was in 2018 when the first Zuckerberg appearance happened. And watching that, I was really, you know, just struck by a few things, as a lot of people were. I mean, first is, I think, just kind of the hubris and the arrogance of people in the tech industry, but also at the same time, kind of the humanity. I mean, you look at Zuckerberg in that situation, and it's so clear he's just an ordinary dude who's gotten in out of his depth and created this thing that has totally changed the world, the way that human communication works. It's reprogramming the minds of and the societies of billions of people. And, you know, it's something that he came up with when he was 22 years old. And so I think that watching that hearing, it became so apparent to me that we just don't have a strong system in place for how to deal with these kinds of emerging new technologies. And I felt like there was a cool opportunity to tell a story that sort of hit on a lot of those big themes and ideas. But, you know, for me, coming at it through kind of a sci-fi new technology was a fun way to get into some of those really juicy ideas I was excited about.
Well, so like in essence, you know, the world and ourselves, we've all been trying to sort of adapt to it. It's funny how I got a 14-year-old, actually turns 15 in 5 days. But, you know, it's like he is so well-adjusted to this new virtual world. You know, he does remote learning for school. And it's funny how, like, Facebook has sort of only just been discovered by geriatrics across the world the past year or so. And it's I guess, with the new... like cyberbullying, that was never a term before. And now, you know, we're all trying to sort of adapt to that. I guess with this, talking about like the, you know, the oversight, how, I mean, I guess, how does it correlate this book to the real world where it's, I mean, I'm assuming at some point where like you can't clone Dolly the sheep and the government's like, nope, stop that. How the real world comparisons with this and your book is what I'm saying in a roundabout, god-awful way.
Yeah, I mean, I think that fundamentally one of the reasons that I was excited about this idea is because the technology that's changing our world is not lasers and robots walking around. It is information technology, fundamentally. And
right,
for those
yeah.
Changes that you're talking about that are happening, like, cyberbullying is this new phenomenon. Those are fundamentally enabled by just new forms of communication and new ways that people are connecting to each other. And I'm going to get like a little ivory tower philosophical for a second, but in a way that I think people actually connect to. I think that the reason that this is so interesting is because we have this fundamental assumption that having more information makes our lives better and makes us more free, that more connectivity is going to improve the world. And you look at how that ethos gave birth to the internet that we have today. It's been just constantly over the course of the past 25 years, more and more connectivity, more people able to share and post and find and consume all of this information. And we kind of went into it going like, this is just going to keep making our lives better. And our lived experience, I think, is it's not all the time. It's
right.
Not always better to have more information. And I would say that more specifically, we think that more information kind of makes us more free, able to make better choices. You know, give me all the information and I can decide what to invest in, where to live, what job to have, who to be friends with. The reality, though, is we're less free as a result of all this access to information. And a lot of that has to do with the algorithms behind Facebook and Twitter and YouTube, the way that people are being shaped and molded by this information. And so I think that that's just this fundamentally different, counterintuitive paradigm that we're living in today. And so coming up with this kind of, you know, sci-fi version of that idea became... looking at how a machine that let you look into the future, you think on some level that's going to make you more free, able to make better choices. But the irony is, if it's really the future, you can't change any of the things that it predicts. And so it's sort of this sci-fi way of commenting on the paradigm that we're living in today, where we all feel so manipulated and controlled by our technology. And you know, I think that we've seen things happening in the real world that are significant consequences of that paradigm as well.
We're visiting with Dan Frey, author of The Future Is Yours, out February 9th. Yeah, look, you know, we don't really deal with a whole lot of politics here, but, you know, with this, with being able to see into the future, and you're talking about information, a lot of times it seems like, you know, people go... not really to go look for the information, but validation as to their opinions. And we've seen sort of how this groupthink hive mind sort of works, where it gets people to act irrationally and believe everything they see. I mean, it's like we have the world at our fingertips with information wise, yet we choose to post pictures of cats and then just seek out things that just validate our own theories, not that, you know, challenge our theories. And that's something where, you know, this is what I like about science fiction. And Dan, like, a lot of times with science fiction, there's not a whole lot of science in that. You've actually sort of worked in, you know, quantum physics with your books, with your book as well. You know, because there's science kind of, without giving anything away, just kind of explain to people how the, you worked the quantum physics in with this storytelling.
Yeah. So I would say I'm just like a huge science nerd myself. And Sweet. So I'm always looking for what's kind of the most credible way that I can tell this story. And one of the things that I've honestly just been thinking about for 10 or 15 years came from learning an idea about quantum entanglement. And without totally, you know, getting whiteboard crazy here, quantum particles are connected, and scientists have found that they can transmit information instantaneously between them, which means because of Einsteinian relativity, you can, and it's constantly happening, send information through time. Now, it's happening like nanoseconds back in time, but theoretically, this means that you could build a quantum computer which could, in a controlled way, send information to an earlier time. So that was one of the inspirations I've been kind of like looking for years for a story to put it in. Mm-hmm. And then when I kind of found this Silicon Valley narrative and the idea of building this product, those two things really locked together and became a cool way to explore some of these bigger themes that I wanted to deal with in terms of, yeah, how we're shaped by the information that we consume. And to the other point that you were making, I think that, you know, it is kind of amazing to think about the way that, you know, we're living in a time period where it should be impossible for conspiracy theories to thrive. Because
right.
You can go find out real information so easily. And yet, how is it the golden age of conspiracy theories? And I think fundamentally it's because the technology, even though it's a portal to truth more than anything, like you were saying, people are using it as a portal to validate their thoughts and even more validate their feelings. And so people who are feeling disenfranchised or excluded from society or oppressed, they're out there looking for any reason to be able to explain that feeling, and they're finding it in conspiracy theories. And those are catching on and causing, you know, real damage. You look at the storming of the Capitol, and that was born out of some really out there conspiracy theories
playing like the
into our world.
Right.
Exactly. Yeah. I mean, QAnon is so immediately disprovable in all of its claims, and yet it's catching on like wildfire, I think, because of the way that these information platforms are serving up what people emotionally want to see more than the truth.
It's astounding how many flat earthers are still out there too. It's just mind boggling. It's like how can you hold on to some of those antiquated ideas? But hey, you know what? As long as they're not hurting people, but as we've seen, those things can change. Dan Frey is our guest. The Future is Yours comes out February 9th. Now, Dan, look, let's get back to this project, but you're also writing a screenplay or whatever the word is for it, for HBO Max. You're making an adaptation. There's the word. So, tell me about, that work with HBO Max, bud.
Yeah, I'm really excited about this, you know, and the book kind of got circulated in Hollywood a little bit, and I've gotten the chance to attach some really amazing people to it. So there's a director on board named Anish Chaganty, who's the guy who did the movie Searching, if you saw that, or Run, which just came out on Hulu. His producing partners as well, Sev Ohanian and Natalie Kasabian, came on board. And then once they got on board, we partnered up with Matt Reeves' company.
He's
Matt Reeves,
Batman,
you know, doing the new.
Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah.
Nice.
And his team has been fantastic. And then, you know, we took the project to market, and HBO Max ultimately became the buyer. And they're just fantastic. They love the concept and love the team. And so currently I'm writing a pilot for it. And so, you know, we're going to keep moving forward and hopefully build out with a writer's room and hopefully go into production like later this year. So it's an interesting experience adapting my own work into another medium, another format, a little challenging to let go of some of the things that I loved in the book in order to, you know, steer it into this new form. But I just think that it's really going to catch on with people, and ultimately they're going to have an emotional experience watching it with the characters that we're creating that I think is going to be fantastic.
But Dan, that's another question I want to ask you about the challenges in writing in the epistolary style through, you know, emails and Tumblr posts and things like that. How challenging is it to write in that form, and then I guess now sort of adapting it to that? Because I mean, I guess you can't have a slideshow on HBO Max of just the screen caps of their emails. How hard is it to write in that style and then adapt it, man?
Honestly, writing in that style for me is easier. I think that style, you know, it's all text messages, email, all of these different styles that are in some ways more personal and casual, and it's easier to read for the audience and easier for me to write. The thing that's challenging in a fun way is that I have to keep switching styles, because the way that an email is written is very different from how a congressional report is written, from how a doctoral dissertation is written. And so that's the fun, nerdy challenge for me as a writer, is I go, oh, this is how I'm going to tell the next part of the story. I go read a bunch of things like that, kind of get inside the head of that style, and then do my mimicked version of it. Then, of course, translating that into a screenplay cinematically is a whole other ball of wax. And there, I think that it's become really helpful that this director, Anish Chaganty, is on board. And he did a movie called Searching, which takes place entirely on a computer screen. It's all website interactions and videos playing and FaceTime calls and all of these things together. And so this kind of cinematic language that he had built sort of became the perfect way to translate this book into a visual medium. And I've really like latched on to what he's done. And I'm kind of expanding on that as I'm writing.
Man, that's all right. Now I'm even more interested than I was before. That is Dan Frey. The Future Is Yours. Comes out Tuesday, February 9th. So, Dan, one last question. What are you working on next? What can you tell us about? What can you tease us about?
So, as I said, writing the pilot for The Future Is Yours, the adaptation. I'm also working on a TV project that hopefully in a few months will get announced, and maybe I can come back and geek out with your audience some more. And I'm also working on my next book, which is instead of a sci-fi book with epistolary form, it's actually a fantasy book using the epistolary form.
Wait,
and I'm really excited
what?
About that too.
All right, so is it all through carrier pigeons and parchments? That sounds awesome though, man.
It's more sort of a contemporary fantasy in the vein of like Neil Gaiman or something.
Okay.
So it sort of starts in our world and is bridging into the fantastical. I think it's another unique challenge. That's always what I'm looking for. And I think it's going to be really cool.
That's awesome. Now I just want to see like a medieval epistolary. It's just like, my lord, a raven has arrived. Good sir. Just be fun.
Well, you know, the first epistolary is probably Dracula.
Yes.
And that is very much in kind of an old-timey Victorian style. So, doable.
Man, I tell you what, when I first saw this come across, I'm just like, it was just such a new idea. And it's like, one of the things I constantly bitch about on the air is just like reboots and just, you know, there's so mm-hmm. many new things out there. And yet we get like, you know, the 23rd iteration of, you know, I don't know, just the Three Musketeers, all those things, you know, it's like, why? You know, I just read that they were going to reboot the Wonder Years. I'm like, why reboot it? You know, I'm a fan of the revivals.
Yeah.
The revivals is cool. You know, when you're bringing back the original cast and stuff. I mean, geez, Cobra Kai, dude. Freaking love that show.
I know.
But, you know, it's not a reboot or anything like that. It's like a continuation. I don't know. It's a pet peeve of mine where there's so much new stuff coming out with just books and comic books, and yet they keep going back to the same well and just giving us the same worn out tripe and tropes and everything like that, man.
I know. And, you know, and whenever there's like one that does well, you know, that makes them do 10 more, even though most of them, yeah, people aren't interested. I think
right.
People are hungry for new stuff and new stories. And it's really just, I think, lazy to not take chances on interesting new stuff.
You know, and a lot of times, one of my favorite authors is Harry Turtledove. He does a lot of the alternative history and stuff like that. And I had him on the show like years ago, and he's written a couple of like sagas of like, you know, an alternate history of World War II, where like World War I sort of happened on the continental U.S., basically the North versus the South. And I mean, it was like an 8-book series, and it kept getting optioned, but people were optioning it so that someone else wouldn't get it. You know, there's these weird things that Hollywood and other big movie houses and production companies, they'll scoop up the rights to a book or something to keep the competition from getting it, and they just sit on it because I think like it can hold it for like 5 years and things like that. And yeah, that's like that's the seedy underside of the whole Hollywood stuff. So you know, it's like, but the stuff's there. But a lot of times they just either they choose not to do it or people option it and then it just sits on somebody's shelf, you know, if it ever really gets made, you know. So it's awesome HBO Max is picking that up for you, man. So congratulations, dude. That's pretty awesome, man.
Yeah, thanks so much. And honestly, like having some awareness of how that system works, I was just, you know, wanted to stay involved in it as much as possible because, you know, it took me like a year and change to set that up. And I could have just sold an option to it from the beginning, but I was like, I want to write it. I want to produce it. Even if it's going to take a lot longer to get there, I want to be involved. So,
Dan, this has been a wonderful few minutes here with you. The future is yours. Hits newsstands February 9th. Dan, where can people get more information, follow you on social media, et cetera, buddy?
Sure. I'm on Twitter. My Twitter handle is @wordsbydanfry. And yeah, people can find the book anywhere online. And I would encourage them to seek out independent bookstores and keep them alive through the pandemic as they order it.
That's one of our sponsors, Tubby and Coos, the nerd mecca down there in the City Park area. So, Dan, thank you so much, man. I appreciate your time and best of luck with your future projects. And I look forward to having you back on this show again soon, man.
Thanks very much. Great talking with you.
You too, man. All right, coming up next, Don McLean will join us. It's the 50th anniversary of American Pie. Bye-bye, Miss American Pie. I took my Chevy to... You know what song I'm talking about. Don McLean is coming up next. And look, I got to interview him earlier in the week. And he goes on this 3-minute rant and talks about Oweem Away, Oweem Away, The Lion Sleeps Tonight, and all the other undertones of like what music means and lyrics mean. And it's freaking phenomenal. So that's coming up next right here on The Week in Geek on News Talk 99.5 WRNO.
I drove my Chevy to the levee, but the levee was dry. Them good old boys were drinking whiskey and rye, singing, "This'll be the day that I die. This'll be the day that I die."
Tubby & Coos Mid-City Bookshop invites you to browse their specially curated collection at tubbyandcoos.com. While the store at 432 North Anthony Street may be closed for browsing, you can order online and have it shipped directly to you or stop by for porch pickups. Follow them on social media for updates and virtual events at Tubby & Coos on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. So toss a coin to your bookkeeper and help Tubby & Coos, the nerd mecca, survive the pandemic and 2020. Go to tubbyandcoos.com today.
And from the Storm, Fanzine highlights Black female characters in comics and sci-fi. The Fanzine is for and by Black women, featuring original artwork, interviews, and cultural criticism. As Black women fans, we have unique perspectives that are often silenced and discouraged in mainstream outlets. And from the Storm is a shelter from the storm, a place for Black women to gather, learn, and discuss our Black female nerddom. Find them at infromthestormzine.com or at infromthestorm on Facebook.
This is The Week in Geek, your source for geek and pop culture news that's trending now. Like them on Facebook and follow them on Twitter at Twig Radio. Do it.
now.
Welcome back into The Week in Geek, your source for geek and pop culture news that's trending now. I'm your host, D-Squared. Let's go to the guest line. Songwriter in the Songwriter Hall of Fame, Don McLean joins us. And if you don't think American Pie when you hear that name, what the hell is wrong with you? Don, how are you doing today, sir?
Well, great to talk to you and great to talk to New Orleans. I miss doing that big New Orleans
Jazz Fest
festival that you had down there, because I had to fly to England to get some sort of a BBC Lifetime Achievement Award or something, but I wish I'd gone to the festival instead.
Well, you know, right. I mean, I don't know when we're going to have another Jazz Fest, but it'll come back. I mean, we've got so many festivals. This is the best part about New Orleans. There's music, pretty much just literally notes flying through the air sometimes. Now, look, Don, I want to ask you right out the gate. When you first made American Pie, were you trying to dethrone Iron Butterfly with the longest song, you know, like Into Gotta Da Vida? Was that the plan?
That was the plan, and I succeeded.
So, 2021 marks the 50th anniversary of American Pie, and obviously, you know, you have not just been resting on your laurels. That's why you received the Lifetime Achievement Award. But tell me what you got on the books for 2021. I guess, really, the first thing, the feature-length documentary, are you finally going to explain the lyrics of the song, or are you just going to keep us guessing, Don?
Well, this is a different kind of documentary. It's going to be much more... something that is going to discuss my life, the life around us in America, the influence of the song. I perhaps will talk a little more about the lyrics, but I don't turn the song into a game show. That's not my thing. That's not what the song's about. But there'll be a lot of things in this documentary that will be different from anyone that we've ever done before. I've had many movies made about me and my career, starting in 1969 with a movie called Till Tomorrow. So I've been documented even before I was very famous, and that's been going on for 50 years, and this is going to be another one of these, but it's going to be different, and there's going to be a lot of personal stuff in this, and I think people will find it very interesting. I hope so. And if I don't find it interesting, it's not going to come out that way. You know, it's going to come out because I'm going to find it interesting, and then I think people will.
You know, I've kind of made an analogy, like your song is sort of like the Forrest Gump of movies, because of songs, because it's just like a little snapshot of time. But you've got a stage play coming up too. What's that going? That's going to be around like Vincent and Castles in the Air and all that as well, right? Because you obviously wrote more than one freaking song, Don. I know that.
I've written hundreds of songs, I've made dozens of albums, and I've had many songs in the top 40 and many in the top 10, and there'll be stories as we go along about my music. Certainly, people that know me know all what I do. There is a segment of the media that really don't want to learn anything, so they'll just go back to that one song when they talk to me. But it's very easy to learn things about me now. You just have to Google my name, and you'll find out all you want to know.
So now you're going to be re-recording the track, though, with Home Free?
So that's already done. The video is coming out today. The audio came out 2 days ago. And they're an a cappella group, and a cappella music, I guess, is starting to take hold and become interesting to young people. So that's exciting.
But look, you know, I was a music major in college. I was a choir geek growing up. And that was something where, like, music is a great tool. And I think, you know, I've followed a lot of your interviews where, you know, it's something that it sort of transcends. Sometimes it's hard to explain. I'm sitting here on the radio trying to explain to people using my words, and I'm fumbling with those words. But the importance of music and telling tales, that's something that I've always sort of tried to explain to people, because a lot of times it's just about the beat. They just go to the club, but there's more to it than that.
You know, that there are three kinds of music that I understand. One is old-fashioned popular music. I know thousands and thousands of songs. Old-fashioned popular music, the kind of songs that, you know, Ella Fitzgerald would sing, or Sinatra, or any of those people. Then I am immersed in rock and roll from the 1950s and early 60s, all of that, deeply immersed in that. And then there's folk music, and I have spent many, many years doing that, and I know a lot about that. So the interesting thing is that prior to the 1960s, most songs were about love, or they were novelty songs. And, you know, really the recording industry didn't really begin until like 1910 or something like that, when we were first selling discs to people, and you had a Billy Murray making one hit after another, you know, Paddling Madeline Home, and I'm Looking Over a Four-Leaf Clover, and all these kind of songs. And then by the time the 60s came along, the folk thing took hold in because of the Kingston Trio, really, in 1957 in a big way. It had started with the Weavers, who were the best folk group and did everything better than anybody else. And they created the repertoire, and that repertoire had to do with stories. Stories about people's lives, songs like Whim Away, The Lion Sleeps Tonight.
Yes.
Going back, it's a political song. It's The Lion Sleeps, the lion are the people, and the people will wake up. That's the story of Whim Away. It's not just some dumb thing in, you know, Ace Ventura. So, you know, these were stories and ideas and political ideas were starting to creep into pop music via the Weavers in 1948. And then the Kingston Trio came along and made playing guitars a fashion and a fever. And all my friends started taking guitar lessons, and everybody started pulling banjos and guitars out of attics, you know, that grandpa had, you know, and whatnot and so forth. And so and then, of course, the great Bob Dylan comes along and starts telling stories. And then a lot of other people follow. And then, so you even have, you know, your big rock bands like the Rolling Stones and the Beatles telling some stories, not just singing songs about love, although they were predominantly love songs, even with the Beatles. But so that's how that got into pop music. And so I was just a child of that era, and it seemed perfectly natural to me. I wanted to get some information, you know, out. I wrote songs like Orphans of Wealth and Tapestry about the environment and Jerusalem and the Seaman, and stories about real people like Van Gogh. You know, this is not just I Love You and You Love Me.
Don, thank you so much. I know I'm sorry we got to wrap, but look, thank you so much, dude. That was the best thing I just heard in my entire life. Thank you, Don.
Thank you.
All right, so full disclosure, I recorded this earlier in the week, and at first, I don't know, it was a very weird interview at one point, because when he started saying about how you media people only want to talk about American Pie, I'm like, in my mind, I'm going, we're all going to die, this is going to be the worst interview ever, but I fumbled forward and kept pushing, and it was, I don't know, somehow I got onto the whole lyric thing, because he's a wordsmith at heart. He is a songwriter, and man, that 3 minutes was just glorious, and you're welcome. All right, I want to thank all of our guests tonight. Dan Frey, The Future Is Yours, comes out this Tuesday, February 9th. Get it wherever fine books are sold, or go check out your local, your bookseller, Tubby and Coos, you know the place. And of course, you know, Skungy, you know, whatever. Way to go. All right, so next week, I'm not sure what we got going on the show, but you'll want to stick around and check it out. Of course, follow us on Twitter at Twig Radio. The Instagram's The Week in Geek. Check out our website at twigradio.com. And, you know, like us on Facebook, facebook.com/TheWeekInGeek. You can check out the podcast on the iHeartRadio app, Spreaker, Apple, Spotify, you know, wherever. All right, till next time, keep your nerd flag raised high.